An Omega-level mutant is defined as a character who has the most powerful genetic potential of their mutant abilities, and is often seen as a mutant with an exceptional level power. The term was coined in 1986's Uncanny X-Men issue 208, but wasn't further elaborated on until the 2001 X-Men Forever series. But even then, one could argue that the description was vague. Omega-level mutants have proven to wield a variety of abilities, from highly destructive energy projection, extreme manipulation of matter, time, and space, high psionic abilities, reality warping, and even immortality, to name a few. Now, despite this, the comics have confirmed a handful of characters who are Omega-level mutants, all of which are compelling and awesome in their own unique ways. So today, we are taking a more detailed look at those characters with our list of the top 10 Omega-level mutants. Let's get to it. Starting us off in at number 10, Vulcan. Vulcan, who was first introduced in X-Men Deadly Genesis issue 1 in 2006, is the younger brother of Cyclops and Havok, and compared to his siblings, he is a baddie. Vulcan, aka Gabriel Summers, had a much more tragic origin story than his brothers. After his mother, Catherine Summers, was abducted by the Magister of the Shi'ar Empire and was killed by him, the unborn child inside of her was removed. That's Vulcan. And then placed in an incubation accelerator, which is normally used to breed slaves. Later, Vulcan would escape after being aged to an adolescent, and was found by Moira MacTaggert with little to no memories of his past. Vulcan is capable of a whole lot. His powers include vast energy absorption, manipulation, transformation, and projection, all of which he does psionically. He can also control exotic energies like Cyclops' optic blast and magical energy. He has limited superpower replication and repression, force field projection and manipulation, psionic resistance, and life support and limited regeneration. Fun fact, Vulcan became an Omega level mutant when he absorbed a massive amount of mutant energies from M-Day. Moving on to our next number, in at 9, Elixir. Elixir is a character who first appeared on Marvel's panels in 2003 in New Mutants Volume 2, Issue 5. He is capable of controlling the biological structure of any organic matter, which also includes his own body, an ability that is dependent on his proximity to said matter. Naturally, this allows him to have great healing abilities, but he can do much more than that. Elixir can boost and restore mutant abilities, he can cause welts and boils to appear on an individual, he can manipulate the life forces of others, create tumors, cure the legacy virus, cleanse the body of toxins like drugs, and even cause death. He's also practically immortal, with his abilities allowing him to resurrect himself, be reborn into a new body, or just regenerate on a cellular level. Must be nice. And it's not just himself that he can resurrect. He was able to affect the 16 million deceased mutants on Genosha all at once, and was capable of resurrecting them, according to Magneto's speculation. The Stepford Cuckoos also transferred Beast's knowledge of anatomy, biology, and genetics into his mind, furthering his capabilities. The one downside, though, is that Elixir can pass out after pushing his powers too far. Moving on to number 8, Legion. Legion, aka David Charles Haller, is the son of Professor Xavier, who is known for his severe mental illness, specifically his dissociative identity disorder, in which each of his alternate personas controls one of his superpowers. Legion first appeared in New Mutants issue 25 in 1985, and his powers include reality warping, shape-shifting, matter manipulation and transmutation, energy manipulation, telepathy, telekinesis, teleportation, and time travel. But here is where things get interesting. His multiple personality disorder is rooted in his telepathy. Because of this, he can absorb other people into his mind if he is right next to them when they die. The manifestation of his individual powers are associated with a different alter ego, each which controls a different power. The culmination of all his personalities and their powers makes him one of the strongest mutants in existence. After the Age of X, Legion was given a neural switchboard wristband, which allowed him to key in a number which stimulates cells in his thalamus and neocortex, creating a one-way link between his mind and one of his sub-selves. This lets him utilize his power sets without being overwhelmed by his other personalities. Moving on to number 7, Psylocke. Psylocke is a mutant who has the ability to construct weapons made of psychic energy, typically in the form of a blade. But that is not all. She has precognitive powers and is capable of telepathy and telekinesis. But let us backtrack for a sec. In her earlier appearances in Uncanny X-Men, she was capable of telepathy, reading, and projecting thoughts over long distances, and capable of manipulating people's minds, even to the point of possessing them. She could also affect people's memories, project mental illusions, subdue and tap into others' powers. Now flash forward to her physical transformation into a Japanese ninja assassin. Yes, that is a whole other story. She gained highly developed fighting skills, and later in the Dark Angel saga, her full psionic potential was unlocked by Jean Grey, but the Jean Grey who originated from the Age of Apocalypse timeline, with it being noted that Psylocke is now a telepath on par with both Jean Grey and Charles Xavier. In at number 6, Mr. M. Mr. M is a character who first appeared in 2004 in District X issue 2, and is an Omega-level mutant who is capable of telekinesis, telepathy, energy projection, and the psionic manipulation of energy and matter on a subatomic level. He has complete control over the atomic and subatomic structure of matter and energy. M has manipulated and generated lightning, fire, and explosions. He's become intangible, has repaired machinery, created force fields, removed and augmented mutant abilities, has created and evolved lesser life forms, and even has displayed mind control. All in all, dude is pretty impressive. Up next at 5, Exodus. Exodus is a supervillain who first appeared in X-Factor issue 92 back in 1993, and was born in the 12th century in France. He would become Magneto's right-hand man after the iconic villain freed him from the crypt that he was locked within by Apocalypse. A previous member of the Brotherhood of Mutants, his abilities include telepathy, telekinesis, teleportation, an accelerated and regenerative healing factor, superhuman physical attributes, and of course, he is immortal. It's speculated that his high power levels may have been a side effect of tampering done by Apocalypse. Exodus once used his mind control powers to command a dozen X-Men to instantaneously fall asleep. He is proven capable of countering reality manipulation, and his powers are too strong to be absorbed by Rogue in their entirety. In addition to that, in the presence of Magneto's acolytes, his powers have proven to excel further. During Avengers issue 369, he simultaneously crushed Genosha via a massive force field, immobilized Scarlet Witch, Quicksilver, Crystal, and Jean Grey in a different force field, resisted Professor X's telepathic control, protected himself from physical attacks, and dished out psionic damage to members of both the X-Men and Avengers team. That's all at once. Not too shabby, huh? Up next at 4, Quentin Quire. Quentin Quire, aka Kid Omega, made his debut in New X-Men issue 134 back in 2003. Initially, he was a bit of a bad egg during his time at the Xavier School, starting up his own gang known aptly as the Omega Gang. But more recently, he was a member of the Fresh Start iteration of the West Coast Avengers, putting his psionic powers to good use. So what exactly do his skills entail of? Well, he has advanced cognitive and telepathic abilities that allow him to construct and organize his thoughts at an incredibly fast rate. He can manipulate the minds of others, both overtly and covertly, resist mind probes, and disable other forms of psychic manipulation. Now, according to Charles Xavier, his powers are deep and subtle, and he's able to influence the minds of those around him. Similar to Psylocke, he can manifest his abilities to create weapons, like a psychic shotgun or explosives. In at 3, Nate Grey. Nate Grey came to be during the Age of Apocalypse story event. He's an alternate version of Cable who hails from Earth 295, the world in which that event occurs. He is the biological son of Scott Summers and Jean Grey, born from genetic tampering by Mr. Sinister. And unlike Cable, thanks to not being infected by a techno-organic virus, he was able to achieve his potential with his telepathic and telekinetic powers, making him one of the most powerful mutants in existence. So what exactly can Nate Grey do, aside from what we've already mentioned? Well, he can manipulate energy and matter, he is capable of psychometry, precognition, teleportation, astral projection, cross-dimensional travel, and energy projection. Sinister had originally designed him so that his powers would inevitably kill him, but after traveling through multiple dimensions, he acquired a special genetic dampener that would prevent that from occurring, and even allowed his abilities to excel further, letting him view and traverse higher planes of existence. He was once measured as having a psionic energy output that matched that of the Dark Phoenix. But after opening a portal to Sugar Man's home reality, he gained acute nerve damage, which almost burnt out his entire power set. Moving on to 2, Jean Grey. Jean Grey's presence on this list should be a given. As one of the initial X-Men members, she's been kicking around in the comics since 1963's The X-Men issue 1, born with telekinetic and telepathic powers. Unable to cope with the full scope of her abilities, Charles Xavier would suppress her access to them, focusing on her psychokinetic abilities while training her instead. But the real reason she's on this list is thanks to the Phoenix Force, which amplifies her powers in an astounding way. Initially, the introduction of the Phoenix was a manifestation of her true potential. But as time went on and multiple retcons occurred pertaining to the Phoenix Saga, Jean and the Phoenix Force became separate entities from one another, with Jean acting as a host, but a unique one at that. She's the only character to ever force the Phoenix against its own cosmic will to do her bidding. According to Women of Marvel Celebrating 7 Decades Handbook, I quote, "While empowered by the Phoenix Force, Jean has total telekinetic control of matter at the molecular level, allowing her to manipulate atomic structures on a universal scale. She can generate any form of energy in seemingly unlimited amounts, as well as absorb energy from sources as great as a supernova, or even convert her physical form to pure energy and back again. The Phoenix Force can also resurrect the dead under some conditions, and absorb the life force from other sentient beings to bolster its own." And last but not least, in at number 1, Franklin Richards. Franklin Richards is perhaps one of the most impressive characters on our list, primarily due to his young age. He is the son of Reed Richards and Sue Storm from the Fantastic Four, whose powers over the years have been established as one of the strongest skill sets to appear in Marvel Comics. Franklin can warp reality to the extent that any thought or desire he has, he can bring it to fruition, even on a cosmic scale. He can rearrange the molecular structure of matter and energy at will, and can even create a pocket universe, which he did one time, subconsciously, which was a replica of Earth 616. Here's where it gets fun though. Several cosmic entities, the likes of Eternity, Infinity, and Galactus, have noted that he is on par with Celestials in terms of his power levels. While it's unknown how far his powers may take him in adulthood, we have seen an older version of him from Earth 4280, who destroyed two Celestials in combat, and then rubbed shoulders with Galactus, looking out into the galaxy, noting that billions of years from now, the two of them will witness the birth of a new universe. So yeah, that implied he was immortal. It's fun. And at number 10, Matthew Malloy. Charles Xavier once called Matthew Malloy the largest mutant power source Cerebro had ever registered. Malloy, who is from Earth 14923, can tap into extra-dimensional power sources that let him warp reality to his will. First appearing in Uncanny X-Men issue 23, and dying a handful of issues later in number 31, spoilers, Malloy has cosmic awareness, is capable of matter absorption, telekinesis, telepathy, can teleport, and can manipulate time. His mutant abilities manifested due to an emotional breaking point. Matthew had witnessed the death of his wife, who had been vaporized by a Skrull ship, while the two were in the middle of an argument. A year later, after his sister-in-law comforted him and told him she still saw him as her brother, he had an emotional breakthrough, which caused his powers to burst out of him. He lost control, which caused an eruption of energy, and accidentally killed his sister-in-law. Awkward. S.H.I.E.L.D. would go on the hunt for him. He would kill Cyclops, Magic, and himself, then resurrect himself, visited the Jean Grey school, killed Emma Frost, and continued to accidentally wreak havoc. The mutant Tempest would have to go back in time to prevent Matthew's parents from meeting, causing him to cease to exist. And at number 9, New Sun. Gambit, on a regular basis, is by no means an Omega level mutant, but on Earth 9921, there is a different version of Gambit called New Sun. A mutant who, as a child, was raised by a government project called Alpha 1, and was molded into a mutant with an expertise and total control of his powers. Something that kind of backfired for the government, since New Sun destroyed the Alpha 1 facility. He has total kinetic control. He's able of manipulating kinetic energy at a molecular level, turning objects' potential energy into kinetic energy, which would then make them explosive. He has no blocks or restraints preventing him from using his powers on living beings, and does not need to make physical contact in order for them to work. In addition to that, he can cause other beings to not move, or cause them to be unable to stop if they are currently in motion. And he can simulate other versions of energy by manipulating the kinetic energy present by increasing molecular agitation. He can also transform himself into an energy wave that allows him to travel through space and into other dimensions in the multiverse. Oh, and he managed to kill his own reality's version of the Phoenix. Eventually, he sought out Earth 616's Gambit and helped him escape Antarctica after he was abandoned there by the X-Men. And in return, 616 Gambit became a bit of an errand boy for this alternate Earth self of his. Moving on to number 8, Mad Jim Jaspers. Mad Jim Jaspers is an insane mutant who hails from Earth 238, and has nigh omnipotent reality warping abilities. Created by Alan Moore, David Thorpe, and Alan Davis, he first appeared in Marvel Super Heroes issue 377 in 1981, and later popped into Earth 616 in Daredevil issue 7 from 1983. On Earth 238, he was a British politician who waged a war on mutants, having an anti-mutant and anti-superhero stance despite being a mutant himself. This was as a means for him to eliminate his fellow mutants in order to ensure his supremacy. Eventually, he lost his sanity and created a cybernetic construct called the Fury, which could track, hunt, and eliminate mutants and superpowered individuals, a tool that turned out to be incredibly efficient in its successful extermination of those individuals, for the most part. His powers consist of dimensional manipulation, time manipulation, genetic manipulation, invulnerability, healing abilities, necromancy, levitation, animation, blast powers, divine powers, reality manipulation, shape-shifting, super strength, and teleportation. He can survive without a physical body, and his powers on 616 actually exceeded his limitations on Earth 238, the latter in which his abilities threatened to engulf the entire reality and spread to other realities, consuming them. And at number 7, the Marquis of Death. The Marquis of Death was considered to be a mutant beyond Omega level, and technically on his alternate Earth he was the most powerful mutant, since he was the only mutant to have existed in that reality. He would teach Dr. Doom everything he knew, with Doom as his apprentice, and Doom would be responsible for killing him too. The Marquis, whose real name is Clyde Wyndsham Jr., hails from Earth 807128, and first appeared in Fantastic Four issue 562 in 2009, and died a handful of issues later, capable of warping reality on a multiversal scale. He can travel between parallel universes, effortlessly obliterate pretty much anything, which also includes entire realities, and can create abstract entities who overpower the likes of Galactus. He could even control Eternity, having the entity battle on his behalf. And that's a scary thought. Clyde essentially made himself the master of time and space. Thank God for Dr. Doom. And at 6, Proteus. Proteus is the son of Moira MacTaggert, a mutant by the name of Kevin MacTaggert, who can psionically manipulate reality. He can manipulate the energy around him at will, with his only limit being his own imagination. Having to live most of his life in forced seclusion, his powers are not to be taken lightly. He exists in a state of pure psionic energy, and has shown he is capable of possessing human bodies, although that usually ends poorly with the bodies of most beings he's possessed burning out within a few days, even a few hours. None of the individuals he's possessed in the past have shown capable of breaking free of his domination. When possessing, Proteus can access all of their memories and retains them even after he's left their body. There is one restraint though. Those with metal in their bodies appear to be immune to his possession, like Wolverine, with metal being his only weakness as it disrupts his energy and can disperse his consciousness. He can manipulate reality by transmuting matter, and he bends the laws of physics. He can turn buildings into liquid, a vehicle into bees, which he then commands. He can strip a person of their mutant powers, reverse local gravity, open fissures in the earth, and painfully stretch individuals into liquid shapes. His abilities are contingent on his line of sight. If he shifts to a different thing to manipulate, his previous manipulation will typically warp back and return to normal. And at number 5, Monarch. Monarch, aka Jamie Braddock Jr., first appeared in Marvel's panels in Captain Britain issue 9 in 1976. He is the brother of Captain Britain, Brian Braddock, and Psylocke, Elizabeth Braddock. Jamie is capable of quantum reality manipulation, which allows Jamie to see the world as invisible string constructs. He can pull these to transform reality. Now, he can only manipulate dense forms, with phased beings showing some level of resistance to him. And formerly, he needed to be close enough to a target to touch the cosmic filaments it or they were composed of, but his range may now have grown. Now, in addition to this, he has also demonstrated sorcery abilities, summoning extra-dimensional creatures and depicting mind control over others. He's proven capable of teleporting and, most horrifically, warping bodies into terrifying shapes. Yeah, no bueno. Moving on to number 4, Iceman. Now, a lot of you guys mentioned Iceman and a few of our upcoming numbers in the comments below, so save them for last. Bobby Drake's abilities have really grown in power since he first appeared as one of the initial X-Men members in the X-Men issue 1 back in 1963. Iceman's Omega power is temperature manipulation, and while it's been stated that he's yet to tap into his full potential, the character's powers can potentially influence the ecosystem of the entire world. He can instantly decrease the temperature of ambient water vapor in his immediate environment, dropping it to below 0 degrees Celsius, which freezes it into ice. Now, the ice doesn't break unless Bobby wills it to, and he can create an array of ice structures, which include projectiles, shields, slides, and he has even crafted miniature cities before. He does not emanate cold, instead he decreases thermal energy, which he can also perceive in objects around him. And when Emma Frost possessed his body, we learned that he can do even more, like control all forms of moisture, freeze the fluids within people's bodies, and travel as liquid, solid, or gas. Up next, number 3, Hope Summers. Hope Summers first appeared in X-Men issue 205 back in 2007, and was the first mutant born after the events of House of M. Hope's ability is power manipulation. She can psychically manipulate and mimic the powers of other mutants, which is an ability that has unspecified limits currently, but mimics her victims' powers at their utmost capacity, which is pretty darn impressive. Her restriction, of course, depends on how close she is to the mutants that she's mimicking. And it's not only mimicry that she can do. She has proven immune to Rogue's lethal absorption powers, with her touch erasing all of the memories and powers that Rogue had previously absorbed. But she also cured her of the Strain 88 virus, so hey, not too shabby. Hope has also proven to jumpstart a newly emerging mutant power to an undefined extent, and she can redirect the force of magnetic fields into negative matter. Up next, number 2, Magneto. It should be no surprise that Magneto finds himself on this list. He was actually who Xavier, in his files in House of X-1, used as an example when defining an Omega level mutant versus a mutant with an Omega level ability. I quote, "Both Magneto and Forge are the most powerful mutants of their power types on the planet, magnetism and technopathy, respectively. But what makes Magneto, and not Forge, an Omega level mutant is that the upper limit of Forge's measurable powers could hypothetically be surpassed, and in fact has by multiple humans on the planet, while the upper limit of Magneto's power cannot be surpassed by any measurable fashion." End quote. So, what do those powers entail? Well, he can manipulate magnetic fields to achieve a wide variation of effects. The maximum amount that he can manipulate at one time is still unknown, although he's proven such feats as moving asteroids and levitating objects like a 30,000 ton nuclear submarine. His abilities extend to an atomic level, specifically the electromagnetic force responsible for chemical bonding, which has given him the power to manipulate chemical structures and rearrange matter. He can generate electromagnetic pulses and manipulate electromagnetic energy right down to the photons. He can turn invisible by warping light and can resist strong telepathic powers, which has often been explained thanks to his helmet or because of his electromagnetic powers interfering with the attack or just from his own willpower. Plus, he's a genius with experience in fields that include genetic manipulation, particle physics, and engineering. He also once had the power of a magnetic personality. But as you can imagine, that kind of fell into obscurity compared to pretty much everything else we just mentioned. He was a charmer. I guess he still is. And last but not least, in at number one, Storm. Storm's status as an Omega level mutant is more of a recent revelation than some of the others on our list. Storm has the ability to manipulate weather, a psionic power that lets her control all forms of weather over vast territories, both on Earth and in extraterrestrial ecosystems. This entails modifying temperature, controlling all forms of precipitation, humidity, and moisture at a molecular level. She can generate lightning and other electromagnetic atmospheric phenomena, and can control atmospheric pressure. She can create tornadoes, thunderstorms, blizzards, and even hurricanes, and then dissipate that weather entirely to form clear skies. She can channel ambient electromagnetism through her body in order to create electric blasts. She can flash freeze objects or people, change atmospheric pollutants into acid rain or toxic fog, fly, of course, and even manipulate the air inside of a person's lungs. She can control natural forces the likes of cosmic storms, ocean currents, solar wind, and an electromagnetic field, along with the ability to separate water molecules into oxygen and hydrogen via electrolysis, which gives her the ability to breathe underwater. All in all, she is one of the most powerful mutants on Earth.
In at number 10, telekinesis. This is a common power thrown around in the world of superheroes, but can you imagine if it actually existed? Being able to move objects with your mind has long been a topic of discussion by scientists, and there's even been odd anomalies of real-life people explaining that they can actually do this. Evidence for how and why, though, is very sparse. Telekinesis defies the laws of physics, so for it to exist in our world on the level that it does for an Omega mutant would impact everything we believe about science. The idea of telekinesis being possible is something we can't even comprehend. Some in the psychic community have brought up that paranormal events of people seeing ghosts move things around could actually be the manifestations of our own spiritual energy being unconsciously released on it. However, even the concept that we have spirits is still a heavily divisive topic in the scientific community. In at number 9, telepathy. This concept of power that we often see mutants using is another human discussion about the possibility of it existing in our reality. What's really baffling about this mutant Omega level power is that it's never been a topic of discussion until the 20th century. We hear occasionally about stories of people being able to read minds, and many mentalists sell the idea that they have harnessed this ability, but in reality, science denies its existence. It's defined as the transmission of thoughts over some distance without the use of any kind of technology. It is a kind of wireless communication between two human brains. Again, though, scientists hark back to the laws of physics as to why its existence wouldn't make sense. The ability of telepathy isn't plausible because no section of the brain is positioned to act as a receptor for long distance communication without the use of technology. In at number 8, energy manipulation. This is the ability to manipulate energy from one form into another. Some magicians have used this phenomenon of energy manipulation to make blindfolded people believe the magician is touching a portion of their body, and by directing them to focus their attention on the body, the end result has been astounding. We do understand energy manipulation to some extent in regards to electricity. We know that this energy can be distributed and transformed into everything around us. However, in terms of phenomenons like the way that Omega level mutants manipulate energy, it's something that cannot be observed, tested, or measured in any way, meaning it is virtually impossible for science to explain how it would work. In at number 7, weather manipulation. Weather manipulation is often referred to as weather modification, and the only way that we can understand it is by seeing a plane seed clouds to increase rain or snow. However, in terms of the way that, say, Storm can use her mind to manipulate the weather into whatever conditions that she wants is very confusing and something we will never be able to understand as humans. In at number 6, Power Manifestation. This is the Omega Power that Legion, the child of Professor X and Gabrielle, seems to have inherited. Not only did Legion take on his dad's telepathic gifts, but his dissociative identity disorder allowed for multiple personalities to each manifest its own powers. The very concept, though, of being able to use mind over matter to manifest power is very woo-woo subject matter in the science realm. In fact, true supernatural powers being manifested into a human has never been proven, and most obscure cases of moments of super strength, say, are attributed to a spike in adrenaline rather than a power that you've always had deep down and just haven't found a way to harness. In at number 5, Matter Manipulation. This is the ability to manipulate the particles that make up the matter and bonds between them. In 1990, IBM engineers manipulated atoms using a scanning tunneling microscope. They arranged atoms on a metal surface to spell IBM. This is interesting that we were able to manipulate matter, but again, it was through the use of technology, so it's no wonder that this method could be explained. What could never be explained is a single individual being able to change the particle structure of an object using their mind. It is truly a science fiction mutant power. In at number 4, Magnetism. When looking at this Omega level mutant power, the first person who always comes to mind is, of course, Magneto. Although Magneto does so much more than just bending forks, Magneto has control over electromagnetism. This is one of the 4 fundamental forces of the universe. Magnetism, though, is one aspect of the combined electromagnetic force. It's the physical phenomena of objects either repelling or attracting. Human magnetism, on the other hand, which is the main category to explain Magneto, is still an alleged ability in the real world. Most people who claim to be a human magnet also believe that their body can attract other materials. This claim, however, disrupts the explanation that they have a magnetism power and implies that there is a different kind of physical effect that's occurring. In at number 3, Reality Manipulation. So many of these powers are impossible for us to understand because of all of these scientific laws that we have in place to understand our reality. So reality manipulation would certainly throw everything we know out the window. When an Omega level mutant uses reality manipulation, it is a very powerful force. It gives them free rein to break the laws of physics and invent their own, which then is imposed on everyone living in said reality. We have altered our reality on a physical level if you consider the industrial age that saw humans building machines and cities to change the reality of everything from war to travel to how we live our everyday lives. On the level of breaking the laws of physics, though, that becomes much more confusing to comprehend. In at number 2, Temperature Manipulation. Bobby Drake, or Iceman, is one of the OG X-Men that can manipulate his own body temperatures to create ice and even enclose his body within it. A state of being that, if possible in the real world, 1, could not be explained, and 2, would surely kill anyone who attempted it. We manipulate our home's temperatures with devices like the air conditioner or a furnace for heat, but to change our own temperature at a moment's notice would be much, much harder for science to explain. I mean, you can adjust your body's internal temperature, but if your core temperature dropped even by 2 degrees, your brain would just shut down from the hypothermia. Last but not least, in our number 1 spot, biokinesis. This is the ability to control and change one's genes by simply using the psychic powers of the mind. Omega level mutants such as Elixir have exhibited this in the past, showing off the ability to change the pigmentation of his skin. The difference between this Omega mutant and us, though, is that Elixir has complete control over his own organic structure and even those closest to him. He has really put this power to the test, displaying the potential for him to be able to bring people back from the dead even. In reality, though, there is no explanation for people who claim they've changed their eye color by using this psychic ability. In most cases, these folks are clickbaiting the internet into believing it's possible if you just believe. Science, on the other hand, says otherwise.
Number 10, Strife. So this is old, things have changed, but he was Omega once, so yeah, here he is. Say hello to Cable's clone. He first debuted in the New Mutants number 86 back in 1990. And more than his powers, what made him so dangerous was the Legacy Virus. He was the originator of that. People can find ways to be a menace outside of their power sets. This virus at first was Legacy 1 and then 2, but eventually mutated into Legacy 3. Version 1 was like a cancer, while version 2 targeted the X gene and would eventually lead to one's powers going haywire before you burnt out completely. This was to try and ignite a war between humans and mutants. Eventually the virus became Legacy 3, which could infect anyone. See, with Omegas you have to worry about so much more, especially if they're villains. Just regular dastardly do, plus what their powers can do when you try and stop them. Strife was stopped, so it's fine for now. That's why he's so low on this list.
In at number 9, Matthew Malloy. Matthew Malloy is a pretty tragic case. He finds himself landing in one of our higher numbers on our list thanks to the fact that he was, in fact, stopped. by some pretty drastic measures. But let's jump back for a second and discuss this fellow. Hailing from Earth 12923, Matthew Molloy had latent mutant abilities that surfaced at one of the worst times ever. His story begins with him and his wife Jules engaging in an argument that is rudely interrupted by the Skrull invasion and a Skrull ship that then lets out an energy blast that vaporizes Jules. His death is then prevented by a SHIELD helicarrier. A year later, Matthew runs into his sister-in-law, Alana, who tries to reassure Matthew, who is in the midst of struggling with some serious trauma, telling him that she still considers him to be her brother. This sweet sentiment causes Matthew to have an emotional breakthrough, which causes his powers to manifest, releasing a massive eruption of energy that then kills Alana. Awkward. He then proceeds to go around accidentally causing mass destruction and is approached by SHIELD director Maria Hill, who does not handle the situation in the best light, further triggering Matthew, who ends up killing Cyclops, Magic, and Emma Frost. Tempest then goes back in time with the help of Professor X to ensure that Matthew's parents never meet, causing him to cease to exist. Molloy's abilities, for the record, consisted of reality warping, energy generation, space-time manipulation, teleportation, resurrection, matter manipulation, did I already say that? Telepathy, and telekinesis. But he's dead now, so I guess he doesn't need to be stopped.
Number 8, Legion. So Legion is Professor Xavier's son, and also has an excellent effects series in its final season at the time of this recording. David Haller first debuted in New Mutants number 25 back in 1985, and is a mutant of incredible ability with a myriad of powers. Unfortunately, his telepathy led to severe mental illness from an early age, when he absorbed his first mind, that of a terrorist leader who had instigated an attack of which David had been the only survivor. His powers manifested, and so did the beginning of his multiple personalities. Initially, Legion only had a few core personalities, who were the gateways to his abilities, but over time that came to be hundreds. Sometimes they would overtake his body and just do whatever they wanted. However, over time, Legion has come to be able to control his abilities, sort of, partially through increased mental control, but also through tech. The thing is, comics have this little problem about progress. Resets, retcons, etc. It's why several people can have different information about a character and all be right depending upon what time period they're talking about. So Legion relapses, it's a thing. So yeah, he needs to be stopped, but with love and support.
Up next, number 7, Mr. M. Mr. M, aka Absalon Mercator, is an Omega level mutant capable of matter manipulation, whose alliance, according to Xavier's files in House of X issue 1, is unknown. Mr. M first appeared in District X issue 2 from 2004 and is capable of psionic manipulation of energy and matter on a subatomic level, as well as telekinesis, telepathy, and energy projection. Now, initially, he was a bit of a loner, but after M-Day being one of the few unaffected, he stepped up, showing off his near limitless psionic matter manipulation chops, which allows him to generate the likes of fire, heat, and even nuclear energy. He can create and evolve lesser life forms too. Neat. He seemingly died but later disappeared from his coffin, and I guess now is confirmed to be alive based on Xavier's files. Now, if Mr. M were to turn against the heroes of the Marvel Universe, he would be a threat that the multiverse may not be able to handle. Here's hoping that that unknown allegiance just ends up meaning, you know, he's impartial as opposed to evil.
Number 6, Professor X. Professor X is a very interesting character to talk about, because in the chasm between him and Magneto, writers tend to move him the most. There's something intriguing about warping someone good, that combined with some people's inherent thoughts about Charles's methods. House of X Charles, so modern Charles, who's back from the dead and living life in Phantom X's body, that's why he's walking again, is a force to be reckoned with. He's wearing Cerebro all the time and ready to subjugate all humanity. Too many lost chess games against Eric. Professor X has been around since the very beginning, since the X-Men number 1 back in 1963. He is classed as one of the most powerful telepaths in the world, and when unleashed, his powers are terrifying, controlling one without you ever knowing, freezing you in place. But what makes Charles so dangerous is the same thing that makes the likes of Magneto so dangerous. It's the courage of his convictions. Charles believes in what he's doing, so if he comes to believe that he just needs to unleash to get it done, which he has a few times, it's all over.
And at 5, Exodus. Exodus first appeared in X-Factor issue 92 in 1993, and his thirst for power ultimately screwed him over. His Omega level ability is his telekinesis, although he is also capable of telepathy, teleportation, has superhuman physical attributes, and an accelerated regenerative healing factor. Oh, and dude is immortal. Yay, fun. Born in the 12th century, Exodus, aka Benedetto Perry, sought out to find the Tower of Power, the domain of the Eternal Pharaoh. Traveling through violent sandstorms, he eventually collapsed, hearing a voice that asked him if he was willing to risk everything to become one of the strong. Generally, you probably shouldn't listen to voices that don't have bodies. He was tested, and his mutant powers manifested. He was then transformed into Exodus. under Apocalypse's command and was later stripped of his power and sealed away in a crypt in the Swiss Alps after he refused to do his bidding and kill his friends. Flash forward to the 20th century, Magneto found Exodus and took him back to Avalon, becoming his right-hand dude and embracing his inner evil. Exodus has the ability to do some pretty terrifying stuff. One time, he simultaneously did all of this. He amplified Genosha Mutant's hatred of humans, crushed Genosha with a massive force field, immobilized Jean Grey, Scarlet Witch, and others in another force field, resisted Xavier's telepathic control, dealt out powerful psionic damage to the members of the Avengers and the X-Men, all while protecting himself from physical attacks. I don't know about you guys, but that is terrifying.
All I'm thinking is that Tower of Power sounds like an 80s album. Number 4, Proteus. So we've talked about Proteus a few times in this channel, and while his abilities are devastating, here on Nerd it's like we're Dr. Manhattan existing in all time periods simultaneously, so lots of facts from different periods. So Proteus debuted in Uncanny X-Men number 125 back in 1979, the son of Moira MacTaggert, locked up from a young age because of the scale of his abilities. Proteus is a being of pure energy, who oftentimes has lived life as a parasite, hopping from host to host, burning up their bodies even though he doesn't have to. He mostly chills in the astral plane now. What many people remember about him is the iconic incident where he melts and warps both Wolverine and Nightcrawler using his powers, and traumatizes them both. Nightcrawler has an entire crisis of faith, and Wolverine is so shook that Cyclops has to throw coffee on him and yell at him to get him to fight again. Which is, yes, a jerk move, but also a distraction technique. There are different kinds of leadership. So Proteus, all reality warpers really are terrifying, and both potentialities of what they can do are equally so. One where you know something has shifted but can do nothing and just run through the streets screaming and until it's either be locked up or adapt. Or the one where you never know. There's just a vague terror. The unknown is that your life is constantly shifting around you. Your likes and dislikes, your friends, your enemies, and you'll never know. A puppet in your own life. A being with no agency being toyed with at the hands of a god. Yeah, not here for Proteus, and neither are the X-Men. Half the time, they're so annoyed to see him.
X number 3, Vulcan. Vulcan is the brother of Cyclops and Havok, the child of Christopher Summers, aka Corsair, and Catherine Summers, who was abducted from his mother's womb by the Shi'ar Empire after she was stabbed to death. Yay. As a fetus, he was tossed into a Shi'ar incubation accelerator, a tool normally used to breed slaves, see all this is really terrible, and was aged to the prime of adolescence. Taking on the name Gabriel, Vulcan is a mutant whose omega power is energy manipulation. He's capable of psionically manipulating, controlling, and absorbing vast amounts of energy, including magical energy and Cyclops' optic blasts to boot. He can go without food for long periods of time by absorbing energy, he can disable large amounts and different types of energy sources, survive in the vacuum of space, which is also terrifying, and can generate powerful enough force fields to allow for interstellar travel. He's also been known to manipulate electricity within a person's brain and use the powers of others by manipulating their own energy sources. Now, the exact limits of this power replication ability is unknown, although he did once use Jean Grey's telepathy without her consent, which is kind of creepy. Now, generally, the character has been known to be a villain. I feel like our whole number kind of defends that fact. But he is loyal to Krakoa, according to Xavier's infograph in House of X issue 1. So here's hoping, maybe he won't need to be stopped.
Number 2, Franklin Richards. Franklin Richards has undergone several shifts in power, but he's an Omega level mutant now beyond Omega thanks to House of X. Also, Cyclops is just gunning to separate parents from children in that story so far. Franklin's age also fluctuates. It's hard with kids and comic continuity, and sometimes they'll just suddenly be teens like a soap opera. Also, Franklin has given himself a superhero name, and it's Powerhouse. Yeah, that's what I'd expect a kid to come up with. I bet Reed Richards just goes home and sighs and is like, I'm one of the smartest men in the world. My son calls himself Powerhouse.
So Franklin has been described as being one of the Celestials. It's just ridiculous. Thankfully, he is baseline good, because if he wasn't, who could do anything about it? It's pretty heavily implied that he's immortal. When it comes to Franklin, not only does he need to be stopped, but so do the writers. Stop it, it's too much power. There's nothing any of us can do except bow to our new god, especially if Cyclops gets his hands on him.
And last but not least, in our number one spot, Magneto. Magneto is not only an Omega level mutant, but one of the most impressive villains to ever grace the pages of comic books. Period. He first appeared in the X-Men issue 1 back in 1963, and his Omega power is, of course, magnetism. He manipulates magnetic fields to pull off a variety of stunts, and the max amount he can manipulate at any given time is still unknown. But dude has proved he's capable of some pretty intense feats, including moving whole asteroids and easily levitating a nuclear submarine that weighed 30,000 tons. He can even use his abilities on an atomic level, manipulating chemical structures and rearranging matter, which, yes, is tedious, but Eric is always up to the task when necessary. He can manipulate electromagnetic energy down to photons, and create force fields which selectively block out matter and energy, which he's used to withstand the simultaneous detonation of multiple thermonuclear weapons. That's not even getting to his genius level intellect or his ability to resist telepathic attacks. He can also read the micro expressions on people's faces to sense what they are feeling and thinking, which Magneto has termed as taking your enemy's measure. Not an Omega level talent, just a neat little trick of his. Needless to say, all of that combined goes to show that there is a reason why he's one of the most persistent villains in Marvel's panels.
Number 10, Moira MacTaggert. If you're familiar with Marvel's new House of X saga, you might be familiar with the new spin on Moira MacTaggert. While some may argue that her powers do not warrant Omega level, as if she dies before her powers manifest, she will be killed for good, she is the only mutant I have ever known to have reincarnation powers. Her powers effectively allow her to change the Marvel Universe, to change the story, and possibly also affect the outcome. Her reincarnation powers also grant her a higher level of intelligence and make her an anomaly in terms of any mutant detectors, which makes her pretty powerful, especially in the mutant versus human wars, which inevitably come about in the X-Men storylines. I would argue that her keeping her memories makes her the strongest mutant of this type so far. Granted, she is also the only one. And I would argue that the potential for her powers has not yet been fully uncovered. Reincarnation is a powerful ability, especially if one can have more sway over how it all comes about, and the time at which you are conceived and born. And who knows, perhaps this could change as Moira continues to develop her abilities. Number 9, Kitty Pryde. You can't hurt when you can't hit. And we don't seem to have anyone with phasing focused abilities yet at Omega level status. So my suggestion for that category is Kitty. Her abilities allow her to phase through solid material, making anything she touches intangible as a choice or making herself intangible. This also makes her almost untouchable in a fight. You might think, well, I bet she is pretty weak to psychic attacks, but due to her phasing, her mind almost appears as unidentifiable to most telepaths, and it's really hard to pin down, giving her a natural resistance to mental attacks. In the alternate Marvel Zombieverse, she was also one of the few superhero survivors, eventually choosing to sacrifice herself to put an end to the infection. Shadowcat isn't just an Omega level mutant in terms of her control over her abilities, she is also just an Omega level person in regards to how many times she actually sacrifices herself for the greater good in the comics. Number 8, Cyclops. I could have easily also included Havok on this list, to be honest. With the discovery of a third Summer in the 2000s who goes by the codename Vulcan, who was already considered Omega level, it is surprising to me that we have not officially declared Scott Summers as such. You might think his optic blasts are not enough to warrant this status, but I would argue against that. The Phoenix Force, when it was split into the Phoenix Five, chose him, and the Phoenix Force is not known for choosing just anyone. If it chooses you, this means you basically have unlimited potential. It has been described in the comics as being drawn to those with unlimited power, and as a result, Scott became obsessed with it once he was possessed by the Force. I'm also a big believer in the idea that the Phoenix Force helps you unlock that potential and reveals your true self, which means that Scott is kind of low-key obsessed with power all the time, and that Jean Grey wants to do what's best but is also vulnerable to corruption by power. And let's not forget that Cyclops has been infused with the power of the Phoenix not just once, but in fact twice. What? Number 7, Jubilee. While I may lovingly poke fun at Jubilee from time to time due to the way her powers are often portrayed in the comics, in the 90s cartoon, and even sometimes in movies, the fact remains that she has accomplished some amazing feats in the comics, including pretty much obliterating Mandarin's mansion when she thought Logan was dead and her powers just went haywire. In fact, when it comes to our discussion about unlimited power in regards to Omega level, Emma Frost once referred to Jubilee as one of the most powerful mutants she had ever met in terms of her potential. Jubilee's abilities have been explained before in the comics as affecting matter on a subatomic level. The explosions she can emit could actually be used in the same way a nuclear fusion bomb could. If that's not Omega, I don't know what is. Number 6, Mystique. The most recognizable shapeshifter in the comic book world, Mystique first appeared in the comics in Ms. Marvel Volume 1, Issue 16. Not only is she the most recognizable shapeshifter, one could argue that she is the most powerful and successful shapeshifter in the comics. She can impersonate almost anyone in terms of appearance and voice, has tricked many into thinking she was someone she was not, and her current resurrection has even gone so far as to allow her to shapeshift into animals. Beyond this, she is also one of the oldest mutants. Due to her abilities, aging for her doesn't really seem to be a thing, and she is close to, if not over, 100 years old. Although I'm not sure if we would call it unlimited potential, she has exhibited an evolution over the years in comics. Granted, this appears to be more as a result of storyline and character development than power growth. She has even been seen turning herself 2D and partially liquefying her body. That is some next level body transformation. Number 5. Psylocke. What I find kind of strange is that Psylocke's not as well known brother, Jamie Braddock, has been elevated to Omega level, and yet Psylocke has not been? Betsy Braddock has two siblings, actually. Her more devious brother Jamie, and her twin brother Brian, who is also known as Captain Britain. Although Psylocke was also Captain Britain for a while. Let's compare Betsy and Jamie when it comes to their abilities. Betsy is a powerful telepath who also possesses strong telekinetic abilities, while Jamie is your average Marvel reality manipulator slash magic user. While he has pulled off some impressive feats, Psylocke tends to be the star of the show when it comes to putting in the work and heroic acts. Jamie is typically presented as the villain of most stories. Psylocke's abilities have always sort of been in a weird state of flux, and while she has been portrayed as insanely powerful when it comes to her telepathic abilities, and then later when she lost those, her telekinetic abilities, it seems that since retrieving her telepathic abilities and her telekinetic abilities, she has become somewhat depowered. I guess she had to split her power level between both abilities? Although she has not been confirmed as being an Omega level mutant, she has been teased as being a character that could be granted such a status. In 2010, Marvel's Uncanny X-Men writer Rick Remender referred to her abilities as being at a burgeoning Omega level. Come on, Marvel, stop teasing and let's see Psylocke join the Omega level ranks. Number 4. Quicksilver. While I recognize that the Maximoff twins have gone back and forth in terms of whether or not they are considered mutants due to so many retcons involving their backstory, I really like them both as mutants. And beyond that, Quicksilver first appeared in the X-Men comic series, so I'm deciding to talk about him as a mutant. I don't know why there seems to be such a huge divide in the comics right now between X-Men and Avengers, actually. You can do both. It's like Marvel is trying to set up the comics and possibly MCU for another X-Men versus Avengers event. I just want everyone to get along. I was actually super surprised when I could not find or think of anything that referred to Pietro as being Omega level. He is, after all, the fastest person in the Marvel Universe. Although he has definitely done some dastardly things, he also proved that he is one of the most powerful when it comes to anything that needs to be done fast. While X-Men Apocalypse was not critically acclaimed and currently sits at 47% on Rotten Tomatoes in regards to its ratings, it also helped to prove just how powerful Quicksilver is when it gave us this scene of him saving all of Professor X's teachers and students when the Academy blew up, including the goldfish. Also, Evan Peters' Quicksilver is just life. Beyond that, he also saved the entire world from the Grandmaster and Challenger during the events of the No Surrender storyline. Number 3. Charles Xavier. Speaking of Professor X, where is he on the Omega level list? I was actually triggered when I couldn't find him listed as Omega level anywhere, and I'm not the type to ever get triggered, but this just blew my mind. Jean Grey is Omega level and is of course more powerful than Charles, so I understand that the reasoning behind this may be that he is surpassed by Jean and therefore does not qualify. However, while both are telepaths, they are sort of different types of telepaths. And honestly, if Emma Frost gets to be Omega level, then so should Charles in my mind. Where Charles and Jean differ though, is Jean's powers are unlimited, but Charles exhibits an intense level of control over his powers. I know this isn't really what Omega is about, but the level at which Charles can manipulate people has also always made me suspicious that there is more to him than a telepath, and that he could potentially later be revealed to be a really strong empath. Him being an empath would actually probably make him the strongest mutant empath out there. Regardless of my suspicions, he is the father of Legion, who has been granted Omega level status, and I feel like David coming in part from him is proof that he has more potential than we've been led to believe. Number 2. Scarlet Witch. I know. Both Scarlet Witch and Quicksilver have been retconned as genetically altered humans, but she was originally a mutant, and before the Avengers and X-Men divide got so weird and intense, she kinda used used to do both. Before her powers got so ingrained in magic, Scarlet Witch had mutant reality warping powers that were simply intensified by her magical bonds. Ignoring her mutant history is like imagining House of M never happened, and that comic event is too good to just let it disappear from your mind. Scarlet Witch was known as Magneto's daughter, and in my heart, she definitely still is. When it comes to reality altering powers, almost no one in the comics has been shown to be on Scarlet Witch's level. She can create armies out of thin air, she made all mutants disappear, and before that, she actually created an artificial paradise world where everyone lived happily until their memories started to resurface and kind of made them question things. She even banished the Phoenix Force from existence. Whether or not her powers will ever return to being classified as mutant powers, she is definitely an Omega level character currently, and should have been classified as an Omega level mutant back when she was one. Number 1. Rogue. Having the ability to have almost any ability should make you Omega in and of itself. That is to say, Rogue has one of the most useful mutant abilities out there. She can steal others' powers and in doing so also weaken them, and all she needs to do is touch someone. Granted, Rogue has been on a long journey in the comics when it comes to trying to control her powers. During the X-Men Legacy series, Rogue was shown to have gained full control over her powers, sharing a kiss with her love, Gambit.
Aww.
However, her control sometimes appears to falter depending on the storyline you're reading. Regardless, she is definitely the most powerful mutant when it comes to absorbing someone else's abilities, life force, and memories, rivaling even Legion's prowess, especially since she can manifest multiple powers at the same time. Thanks so much for watching, fellow nerds. I hope you enjoyed this list. Who do you most want to see join the ranks of Omega level mutant? Who's your favorite mutant? Let us know in the comments below. And who do you think my favorite mutant could be? Could it be Rogue? I'm definitely super excited though to see what other lesser known mutants both the House of X and Powers of X series are going to bring back and flush out. I might find a new favorite there. They are just doing a killer job so far. While you are on your way down to the comments, be sure to click that thumbs up and tap that subscribe if you love mutant kind as much as I do. And remember to ring our bell so you never miss another nerdy list. This has been Top 10 Nerd, and I'm your host, Amanda McKnight, reminding you to stay nerdy, YouTube.